Yo, what is going on, everyone? My name is Nick with the Notorious Fantasy, and in today's video, we're going to be doing a 12-team mock draft on YahooFantasy.com. In today's video, we're going to be talking about all of my picks from pick number 11, as well as the picks surrounding me as we go on through the draft, so you guys can get a good idea of how I feel throughout 2021 fantasy football drafts. If you guys do end up enjoying this video, please make sure to hit that subscribe button down below, because not only is it free, I put out content every single day to help you guys win your 2021 fantasy football draft. So without further ado, let's get into it. Now, the beginning of drafts are very, very basic, if I'm being completely honest with you. We're going to be seeing Christian McCaffrey, Dalvin Cook, Derrick Henry, Saquon Barkley, Jonathan Taylor, and Alvin Kamara likely go inside of the top seven, six-ish picks of the draft. It's very, very basic at the beginning, but what I find so interesting about the draft is when we get back to where I am at pick number 11, because that's when the draft really starts to get interesting, at least in my opinion. I'm going to actually move myself down to the bottom of the screen so that you guys have the best view of the draft board. So the draft went as follows: Christian McCaffrey followed by Derrick Henry and Dalvin Cook. With this new news about Julio Jones obviously being traded from the Atlanta Falcons to the Tennessee Titans, that really does open the door, in my opinion, for Derrick Henry to score even more points than he probably could have scored without Julio Jones on that team. So I like Derrick Henry a lot. Dalvin Cook, Saquon Barkley, Alvin Kamara, Ezekiel Elliott goes as follows. So draft at the beginning are so running back heavy. That's why I try to go ahead and snag two running backs with my first three picks basically every single time, because I see this trend of the running backs going so early, and I feel as though my wide receiver core can be built much later in the draft. And that's basically how every single fucking person feels in this draft, because it's been all running backs after Zeke, Jonathan Taylor, and Nick Chubb. I would be very interested to see where the first wide receiver goes, and it is right here, Tyreek Hill. Now, personally, if you want to be safe, I would go with Devontae Adams as the wide receiver one off the board. If you're playing a little bit more risky, maybe you go with Stephon Diggs, because obviously we don't know what is happening with Aaron Rodgers, Aaron Jones, Devontae Adams here. Now, I'm just going to go ahead and assume that Aaron Rodgers ends up coming back here, and I will end up drafting Aaron Jones, running back of the Green Bay Packers. I think that his upside is very limited if Aaron Rodgers ends up leaving, because I don't think the team's going to be able to march as effectively up the field to score points for Aaron Jones, obviously handing the ball to him and having him score so many touchdowns. But there is still potential that he's just about all right without Aaron Rodgers and with Jordan Love under center. But again, his upside is definitely limited without one of the better quarterbacks in the NFL under center. Basically, that could be said about any player. So after Aaron Jones, Devontae Adams, as well as Travis Kelce, were selected off the board here. So many running backs have came off the board that I feel as though the running backs are just going to keep on coming off the board. So I'm going to go ahead here and take another running back. I like Gibson, I like Eckler, but if I'm being honest with you, I think I like Akers the most out of that group. I think that this LA Rams offense is going to be basically unfucking stoppable with Matthew Stafford under center. I think that Matthew Stafford is going to take this team to the next level. Now, they were already a playoff team last year with Jared Goff. They've already been a team that was in the Super Bowl with Jared Goff, but I'm telling you, Matthew Stafford is going to make this offense move up the field smoothly like butter. I frankly love Cam Akers, but would I have judged you if you picked Eckler or Antonio Gibson at that spot? No, because I think all of those guys easily have top 10, if not top 5 potential. So I start my draft with two guys who I assume are going to be top 10 running backs in Aaron Jones, as well as Cam Akers. Again, the Aaron Jones kind of experiment is going to be tough, because if Rodgers ends up leaving and going to Denver, I won't have loved that pick. But right now, at the value of getting him as running back 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 off the board when I have him ranked as running back 6 to me is good enough value. I have Cam Akers ranked as a top 10 back, and I got him in the second round. So again, I am very happy with that. After Travis Kelce, Cam Akers, Austin Eckler, Antonio Gibson, J.K. Dobbins, DeAndre Hopkins, as well as A.J. Brown, followed by Calvin Ridley. Now, with Julio Jones exiting the Atlanta Falcons, that really opened the door again significantly for another player, and that is going to be Calvin Ridley. Ridley has performed, though, pretty well with Julio on the field and pretty well without Julio Jones on the field. So I don't think it really affected him all that much, as some people may try to talk about it, but obviously it's good news for Kyle Pitts as well. After Calvin Ridley was DK Metcalf, Joe Mixon, and Keenan Allen. Very interesting to see Devontae Adams be the wide receiver 3 off the board, because maybe, I guess right now the assumption is maybe Rodgers won't be there, which I do kind of understand that narrative. But if Rodgers is there, Devontae Adams is locked and loaded into getting so many targets. I frankly don't understand why the Green Bay Packers did not go ahead and overextend and try to pay a big amount of trading assets to get Julio Jones, because then obviously Aaron Rodgers is going to mosey his way back into Lambeau Field, fucking lace up the cleats and get ready to go on Sunday. But without them making a move for Julio, unless they tried to make a move for Julio, I don't think Aaron Rodgers is going to be very happy about that. After Metcalf was Joe Mixon, Keenan Allen, Justin Jefferson, Terry McLaurin, and Michael Thomas. So the wide receiver brigade is going to start firing at all cylinders here. After the second round is when you really start seeing the wide receivers fly off the board, because people aren't as confident in the running backs available. Right now, looking at the top running backs, Miles Sanders, DeAndre Swift, Najee Harris, people may be a little bit more nervous about them, whereas people are very confident in a lot of these wide receivers. A guy like Michael Thomas was the unanimous wide receiver one going into drafts last season, and now a lot of people are hating on him. The slant boy just didn't play all that good last year, I understand, but the fact that he's going as a third round pick when he could easily be a top five wide receiver, to me, is a bit ludicrous. After that is Pat Mahomes, followed by Miles Sanders. So this kind of taking a quarterback early approach to drafts is just something that I don't like. But in the third round, I can understand it. I can understand pulling the trigger on Patrick Mahomes there, because you got Mixon and Dalvin Cook. This guy assumes Mixon's going to be great. He assumes Cook's going to be great. So now he's got his quarterback here in Patrick Mahomes. Patrick Mahomes is easily the safest quarterback in fantasy football, because you know that Kansas City Chiefs offense is going to be very potent in scoring points as well as moving the ball all over the field. So I think Patrick Mahomes should be very solid, but again, I'm not too sure I love picking him, but he's going to go in the first round in a bunch of leagues, so don't be surprised when that happens. After that is Miles Sanders, George Kittle, and DeAndre Swift. Interesting to see where at this point in fantasy football drafts, where Kittle and Waller go, because personally, I think Waller is actually better than Kittle, because it seems like Kittle can't stay on the field for the whole season, and Waller really has not had those struggles in his last two seasons, where the guy has been fucking amazing for fantasy football for the Raiders. After DeAndre Swift was Allen Robinson, Najee Harris. This team is absolutely stacked. Nick Chubb, J.K. Dobbins, and Najee Harris. I love Najee Harris a lot in the third round. Me, that is very, very safe. In the second round, you're definitely taking some risks on the fact that he's a running back, but even then, I do still feel confident even with a bad offensive line in Pittsburgh. Followed by Najee Harris is Clyde Edwards-Helaire and Josh Jacobs. I hate that Josh Jacobs pick, and that's why I don't really love drafting running backs in the third round. So we're gonna jump onto the wide receiver train here and select wide receiver Julio Jones of the Tennessee Titans. I understand that he's not the wide receiver one on this team, that AJ Brown should be getting a lot of targets, but that also means that Julio Jones is going to be commanding a whole lot of targets in this offense. I think the Tennessee Titans offense is going to be amazing, so I'm very confident with Julio Jones being my wide receiver one on my roster this season. I think Julio Jones, even as a wide receiver two on a team, can be very dangerous. After I went with Julio Jones came Chris Carson, followed by Michael Thomas. So we are back up on the board here, and I'm looking to snag another running back. Now, I would have loved to get Chris Carson, who went ahead of me. Chris Carson's body looks beautiful. Looks fucking etched out of stone. The guy looked like he worked super hard in the offseason. I'm going to go with David Montgomery here. I think I slightly like Myles Gaskin more, almost, but I would find it hard to pass on David Montgomery at this point in the draft as my running back three. As a running back two, I think David Montgomery comes with a decent amount of risk due to the fact that, obviously, Tariq Cohen is going to be playing a lot of games, and Tariq Cohen sucks up a whole lot of targets from David Montgomery. A lot of David Montgomery's value coming deep down in last season was when Matt Nagy was not calling the plays, as well as to when, you know, Tariq Cohen was hurt, because he was hurt for a lot of the season, and that really helped out David Montgomery. We'll see how involved he is in this offense with Tariq Cohen. I think it does definitely take a huge hit to his value that he's not going to be catching as many passes. But again, in the fourth round, I'm willing to take that shot that maybe he will end up with more targets than I believe he will. Again, he's my running back three. If he was my running back two, I think I would be a little bit nervous with David Montgomery, but at this point in the draft, you know, you can't be all too mad with that. After David Montgomery came Darren Waller, Chris Godwin, Adam Thielen, as well as Josh Allen. Second quarterback off the board. All three of the big tight ends have already been taken. Travis Kelce, George Kittle, and Darren Waller. If I'm being honest with you, if I'm this guy, I am punching the air right now at the fact that I took George Kittle here, because I just feel like the value in the fourth round on a tight end like Darren Waller, who's on the Las Vegas Raiders, who should be a pretty solid offense with not the greatest of defenses, you should be pretty happy with Waller, considering George Kittle's injuries concerns at this point definitely do concern me. It wouldn't concern me with drafting him necessarily in the third round, but just knowing the fact that Waller fell a round later would make me a little bit mad. After Allen was Amari Cooper, followed by Bobby Trees. I like Robert Woods a lot. Again, I've talked a lot about this LA Rams offense and how unbelievable I think it will be with Matthew Stafford there. One of the biggest worries, though, has to be of what could stop these wide receivers is the fact that the defense is so strong and they are going to be up in a lot of games where a guy like Cam Akers, who I drafted early on in the draft, will be getting a whole lot of touches and opportunity in the game. That's why I like Akers so much. But again, it doesn't stop me from loving Woods, from loving a guy like Cooper Kupp. I still think they could all be solid, but just understand there's going to be some games where the wide receivers shit the bed because the defense just plays so strong. They're able to run out the clock late in the game with Cam Akers, as well as obviously Darrell Henderson getting some touches after Robert Woods was wiki-wiki. DJ Moore followed by Miles Gaskin, Kareem Hunt, and Chase Edmonds to close out the fourth round. After Edmonds, the fifth round begun with Tyler Lockett, followed by Mike Davis. If you guys have ended up enjoying this video thus far, we're about 10 minutes in the video. Please make sure that you hit that subscribe button down below. I would appreciate it a ton. So after Mike Davis was TJ Hockenson. Hockenson is a guy that I really like in fantasy in 2021 due to the fact that the Lions team as a whole fucking sucks and they're going to have to be throwing the ball late in games, and that's going to help out TJ Hockenson a ton. That's kind of why I'm not in love with DeAndre Swift on their team. Now, a lot of people are really hating on DeAndre Swift. They're saying DeAndre Swift is a do-not-draft running back. I don't really feel that way. I'd be pretty happy with Swift on my team in the third round, but I do understand the concerns because if he's not getting all of this pass-catching opportunity, then frankly, DeAndre Swift's going to be screwed in the third, fourth quarter of the game, the second half of the game, when they're going to have to be passing the ball a ton because their defense has completely sold the game out. After Lamar Jackson came CeeDee Lamb, followed by Melvin Gordon, Deontay Johnson, Cooper Kupp, and Kyler Murray. This is the point in the draft where a lot of quarterbacks are going to go. Someone takes Lamar Jackson, then someone panics. They take Kyler Murray. It happens all the time. It could happen in the reverse. Someone's going to panic, pick Dak, pick Justin Herbert, pick Aaron Rodgers. This always happens in the middle of the draft. That's when a lot of the quarterbacks are going to go. Unless, of course, you're in a league where quarterbacks go very heavily early on in the draft, where rounds one, round two, like six quarterbacks are gone, which does happen in a lot of more casual leagues because people believe that quarterbacks are the most important position in the NFL, which they kind of are, that they're more important in fantasy, but that's not really how fantasy football works. After short god Kyler Murray comes Kenny Galladay, Kenny Bones. So now we're back up on the board here. We got Julio Jones, Aaron Jones, Cam Akers, and David Montgomery. So we're going to go with a wide receiver here that I think has a decent amount of upside. I'm not too sure if I want to go Ayuk, Claypool, or Sutton, but I am going to go ahead and take Chase Claypool. I do think the Steelers are a very solid team. Well, I do believe that they are going to be running the ball more, therefore throwing the ball less. I still think that Chase Claypool is the second or first best option on this team for Big Ben to throw the ball to. So with that thoughts alone, I think that he is definitely worth being a pick inside of the fifth round. Next up, we're probably going to take yet another wide receiver because the running backs here, I am not in love with. I do kind of like Damian Harris, but I think I'd feel a little more comfortable just waiting and taking some more shots since I'm already pretty comfortable with Jones, with Akers, and with David Montgomery. I don't really love these tight ends. I'm not going to draft a quarterback this early, so we're going to go ahead and snag Brandon Ayuk. Obviously a rookie last year, put up some big numbers. The question is, how is this offense going to look with Trey Lance? Because I'm not too sure that this is going to be a Jimmy Garoppolo quarterback team for a majority of the season. I think that it is going to be only a couple of weeks in, especially if they start losing, until the boos start roaring in and we end up seeing fucking Trey Lance under center. I'm not sure if that helps Ayuk. I'm not sure if it hurts Ayuk, but frankly, I think that Brandon Ayuk is a good enough wide receiver that it should not matter who the quarterback was. We kind of saw that last season with Jimmy Garoppolo hurt. Big Dick Bethard comes into the game. All these other quarterbacks are playing, and frankly, it doesn't matter because he is such a talented wide receiver at the NFL level. After I went ahead and drafted Mr. Brandon Ayuk, came Russell Wilson, Mark Andrews, Justin Herbert, and Leonard Fournette. See here, in the fifth and sixth round, we see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 quarterbacks come off the board. That is because, again, people start to panic. They see Kyler come off the board, and then they're like, you know what? I need to get Dak. And then this guy's like, fuck, I'm not going to get a quarterback in like the eighth round. Now I need to reach on Russell Wilson. Now I need to pick Justin Herbert. Make sure the most important thing when drafting in fantasy football, honestly, is just controlling your fucking thoughts. controlling your head. Make sure that you don't panic during the draft. Make sure you come in there ready. Make sure you come in there researched, because if you're not ready, you are going to be making panic picks. You are not going to be prepared for how the draft is going to go. When you're drafting on Yahoo, ESPN, NFL, when you're drafting on a real life fantasy football board that's on the fucking wall, anything goes. It's like a bare knuckles boxing match, basically, where you can just fucking gouge some guy's eyes out. That's basically how it works. But when you're online on a website, the ADP is built in there. You're going to be seeing guys come off the board in a pretty similar order every single time because of how the screen has presented the draft. In like a real life draft, things just go absolutely haywire. You'll see people reach up like 3-4 rounds to get a guy because there's no real ADP. They're just looking at a sheet, which obviously you can take to your advantage or can severely hurt you because you're reaching heavily on these guys. But again, when you're drafting on a website, which is what a majority of people do, doing these mock drafts, being well prepared, watching my videos, watching other videos. Again, I'm not someone who just completely sucks myself off, right? I'm not over here sucking my own dick every single day on here. I hope you're doing research. You're watching my videos, even if you like other people's videos more. That's fine with me as well. Go ahead and watch them, continue to learn, and make sure you get better, because if you're not paying attention, you are going to make panic picks. Even I've seen it happen all the time where people panic. Happens in every draft, and the more prepared you are, the less likely it is that you're going to be shitting your pants on draft day. And obviously, if you're watching a video in June, that is much less likely to happen. So after Dallas Goedert came off the board, came James Robinson, Damian Harris, Odell Beckham Jr., T. Higgins, Raheem Mostert, Kyle Pitts, Aaron Rodgers, Juju Smith-Schuster, and Noah Fant. Interesting how this many tight ends have been coming off the board. Kyle Pitts in the 7th round. Kyle Pitts we saw go in the 3rd round a couple mocks ago on Yahoo with real people, so it's interesting to see where he moves up and down in the drafts. I think he's going to be a guy that by the time we're drafting in August, people are going to kind of parade him as a 4th round draft pick. And at that point, I'm out. But in the 7th round, I'm pretty excited to take him. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 out of the 12 teams have a quarterback. Me and one other fella slash lady. What's a lady fella? What do you call them? Fella-ettes, maybe? Like, they haven't taken a quarterback, so we can continue to wait. But make sure you understand that once people start taking two quarterbacks, you need to make sure you get your one, because otherwise you're going to end up in Shittsville, USA, having your starting quarterback be someone that I wouldn't want to be my starting quarterback. Now, again, I like Tua for fantasy. I think he has upside. But do I want him to be my quarterback one? No. I don't even like Daniel Jones that much. I don't want him to be my quarterback one. As a quarterback two, sure, it's worth the upside, but I'm not too willing to have him be my quarterback one. After, we see Jalen Hurts, Tampa Bay, Tom Brady, Tyler Higbee, Curtis Samuel, Ronald Jones. I love Tyler Higbee as a late round sleeper, but what the fuck is this? In the 7th round? Now, something came up today that Irv Smith will not be seeing more targets in 2021. What type of bullshit is Mike Zimmer spitting into a microphone to think that? There's no way. There is literally no way. If he gets not as many targets as I think he will, I'll be shocked. Jamal Williams in the 7th round. That's a little crazy. That's a little bit crazy. Very crazy. So we're going to go ahead and hop onto the quarterback train here because, again, they are going fast. I like Stafford. I like Tannehill. Personally, I have Stafford ranked higher. You could go with Tannehill as well. I am going to stack my quarterback with my wide receiver. Ultimately, Ryan Tannehill, Julio Jones, the stack of the century here. Hoping that Julio is able to stay healthy. Again, a lot of people try to smack Julio upside the head with the fact that this guy's kind of injury prone. Hasn't missed that many games in his career. It was really just last year where he ended up getting hurt, so don't worry too much about that. But we kind of do need some running backs here, even if these guys I'm not ultra confident in. I think I'm willing to take them. David Johnson, even I don't love David Johnson, but there is potential that he ends up finishing as a running back too. If they insist on pounding the rock like they say and David Johnson takes over, then I'm willing to draft him. But again, I'm not looking at him to be my starting running back. I'm not. I'm going to take him here, even though in a lot of situations, I might want to take Zach Moss more, might want to take AJ Dillon more. I think he is the starter on the team, but this is a very crowded backfield in Houston with Phillip Lindsay, with Mark Ingram. So again, if you're in the 8th round and you're looking for some upside, I think David Johnson does have it, but he definitely is not as safe as he was in the past in Arizona. Last year, he completely fucking disappointed me big time. I thought he was a pretty solid 4th, 5th round pick. While he wasn't terrible, right, he didn't go out there and play like complete dick cheese week in and week out. He's not the guy, pal. you're not that guy, pal, basically, was what David Johnson was. So after we went ahead and drafted Ryan Tannehill, Cortland Sutton came off the board, followed by Los Angeles defense, David Johnson, DJ Chark, Washington, and Robbie Anderson. So it was not Jamal Williams. I completely got my Jay Williams wrong. It was Javonte Williams, second string running back for the Denver Broncos. I think he has a lot of upside. I'd honestly rather take him than Melvin Gordon. Gordon in the fifth round to me is a significant overpay, especially if the Broncos continue to try to work that split system, what they're doing with Phillip Lindsay as well as with Melvin Gordon. We are just seeing a complete and utter split of the carries, and you're just pissed. You're absolutely pissed week in, week out, because you don't know which guy to start, to the point where you're tearing your head out and you just wish you didn't start either of them, because they're each going to get like 8 points, and unless one of them gets hurt, you're going to be significantly disappointed in them. But Nick, you just drafted David Johnson. That's basically the same thing. It kind of is. But again, I got David Johnson at a 1-2-3 round discount compared to Melvin Gordon. That's just about how I see it at this point for fantasy football. After Robbie Anderson came the Pittsburgh Steelers defense, the Baltimore Ravens defense, and the 49ers defense. Now, I would like to urge you guys not to draft a defense early in your drafts. I'd like you to wait till the last two rounds to go on to Google. I'm going to actually make a video about this in August, which defenses to draft based upon their week one matchups. I try to find soft as baby shit week one matchups where I think this defense is going to lay the smack down Hulk Hogan style on the offense, and I think that the offense is just not going to play too well. The defense plays pretty good. Boom, that's your defense for week one. Then week two, if they don't have that great of a matchup that week, you just cut them. You watch week two video, week two defenses to stream, and then boom, week two, week three, you just keep on watching the videos for the defensive stream. You keep picking them up, and you keep winning your week, because paying this high of a draft capital for this, or for Justin Tucker the fucker, is frankly crazy. It's crazy. You could find a running back or a wide receiver here that could finish top 10 and literally win the whole league for you. That defense, unless they end up being the number one defense, this Justin is not going to win your league for you. You need to find that great defense that you can start every single week, but that's not what I'm looking for. It happens every year. There's always those couple of teams that are really good a couple years ago, the Bears a couple years before that, the Jaguars, where they're just so good week in, week out, but it's very hard to find that. And typically, these really good defenses don't repeat year in and year out. After we saw Matthew Stafford and we saw Kenyon Drake, we also saw Harrison Bucker the fucker. So again, same thing goes with kickers. I think that kickers are very important in fantasy football, and they kind of get under talked about considering they're in your lineup every single week, but you also don't have to draft them in the ninth round. There's guys like Young Hoku, Jason Sanders, every single year that basically go undrafted, untalked about, and they end up tearing it up. So again, speaking of Young Hoku, by old bitch lame, but my Young Hoku going in the ninth round, I love Young Hoku, Greg the Leg Zuerlein. But again, I don't think you have to pay this heavy of draft capital for them. I think that in a majority of drafts, they will end up going later. But again, you never know. People are crazy in drafts. They panic. They want to go ahead and get their guys. So we got our quarterbacks. We got basically everything except for a tight end. But again, we're going to continue to build up on that bench. Looking at tight end again, I love Irv Smith. This news blurb will probably tell us that Mike Zimmer said tight end Irv Smith should not have a bigger role in this team's offense in 2021. Are you kidding me? That's a straight up lie. Has to be a straight up lie. There is no way anyone believes this straight up malarkey. No one believes that. So we're back up on the board here. We're going to go ahead and attack the running back or wide receiver position at this pick. Zach Moss still here. Gus Edwards still here. These are two guys I'm targeting heavily in the late round. I think Zach Moss has a higher potential to become the starter because I think J.K. Dobbins is the starter guaranteed in Baltimore, whereas I think Moss could actually beat out Singletary in Buffalo. After I picked Moss, Robbie Gould came off the board, followed by Will Fuller. So we're back up on the board here. We can honestly snag another running back, but we only have three wide receivers on the roster. So I want to go ahead and snag an upside shot here on Ja'Marr Chase, wide receiver of the Cincinnati Bengals. Now, I do think this is going to be a relatively crowded offense, but I do think that Ja'Marr Chase's connection with Joe Burrow should be significant enough from the collegiate level to move on to the NFL and have Ja'Marr Chase potentially be a legitimate wide receiver one in fantasy football. I think that's possible, but I also kind of like the other rookie wide receiver, Devontae Smith, who's not going until later, I believe, right? Yeah. 103 on the rankings. He's going to go a little bit later. That guy is a very sneaky pick because he could easily be the number one wide receiver from a rookie standpoint in fantasy football because he's the clear number one in that offense. Ja'Marr Chase is kind of in a jumbled, not really a jumbled offense, right? The offense should be good, but he's in a jumbled spot because he's not necessarily guaranteed to be the number one guy. They still have Tyler, yeah, Boyd. They still have Titty Boy T. Higgins, so it's not necessarily a guaranteed spot for Ja'Marr Chase in that offense, but again, it is definitely an upside shot when I already feel safe with Julio and Claypool, and then Ayuk, I think, is a pretty decent shot as well, so I'm not really too worried when it comes to the wide receiver position. Again, that's why you wait till later to draft the wide receivers, because there's so many shots you can take deeper in the draft, these late-round shots that could end up legitimately paying off tenfold, whereas it's kind of hard to find a running back here, unless of injury, nothing like, unless maybe Michael Carter becomes the guy, right? In my opinion, he could easily become the Jets starting running back, but that's kind of known going into the draft, right? Whereas at wide receiver, it's kind of just very possible that 2-3 wide receivers on a team can light it up week in, week out, and you're very happy with them. So hopefully Michael Carter ends up falling to us. I doubt it, but he is a guy I'm definitely targeting very heavily in the late rounds of my fantasy football drafts. Again, we're about 26, 25-ish minutes in this video, so if you have enjoyed thus far, please make sure you hit that subscribe button down below. I'll move myself up to the top here because I don't want to cover the bottom of the board. Again, my picks, I guess I'll just shrank myself because you can see my name, Nick, over there. I am pick number 11. So our draft has went very solid thus far, if I'm being honest with you guys. I feel very confident with the team that we have kind of built upon throughout this video. Edgar, get the hell out of here. We're going to Nick. We got Ryan Tannehill, Julio Jones, Chase Claypool, Aaron Jones, Cam Akers, David Montgomery, Brandon Ayuk, David Johnson, Zach Moss, and Ja'Marr Chase. We do definitely need a tight end relatively soon, but again, we're at the point where we're just straight up fucking taking a punt Pat McAfee style at the tight end position because we've waited so long. We've waited so long to where it really is a punt, but I do think Irv Smith's going to be good regardless of what this fucking bullshit coming out of Mike Zimmer's mouth is. There is no way that he's not involved. If he is not involved, I would be so shocked. It would make no sense because he was just so good. He was literally just so good when Kyle Rudolph was hurt that it would just be so crazy. So crazy if he wasn't the featured tight end in that offense. Michael Carter gets picked, of course, because when you put a guy in your queue, it's basically a queue jinx. I never put guys in queue, but I got fucked by it. Never do that, because to me, it just always seems like a jinx. Like, I put them in my queue, it means that I'm thinking about them, and then somehow the other people just know that, even though that's not how it works at all. After I went with Ja'Marr Chase came Mikey Mike Williams, AJ Dillon, Hunter Henry, Tyler, yeah, Boyd, Brandon Cooks, who I like as a late round shot, because he's definitely the wide receiver one in Houston. And the question is, what is the quarterback going to look like there? Ty God, Deshaun Watson, Davis Mills, who knows? After Brandon Ayuk came Gus Bus Edwards, Tony Pollard. After Brandon Cooks came Gus Edwards, Tony Pollard, Devin Singletary, bunch of defenses, Ryan Succop, James Conner, Michael Carter, Robert Tonyan, Trey Sermon, Joe Burrow, Logan Thomas. So again, we have two bench spots left. Going to try to get a running back and a wide receiver, and then we're going to draft our tight end some point in here. Might have to draft Irv Smith, because frankly, after Irv Smith, I'm getting worried. I am going to be shaking in my britches if we don't get Irv Smith, because after that, we've went from a punt to like closing my eyes and throwing it, kicking it backwards. Basically is how it works in my opinion. So Irv Smith will be the guy here. Again, I'm not buying into that narrative from Mike Zimmer. There is no way that this is true. There's no way. Oh, Nick, why don't you fucking read into it? Nick, you fucking idiot. He's saying what he believes. I don't believe it. I think he's masking it. He's putting on a full cap. He's capping. He's lying straight to our fucking face. I genuinely believe that. There is no way he's being serious. So we need a running back. We need a wide receiver. We're going to go with running back or wide receiver here. Let's see. Jeff Wilson's a nice shot, but again, he's going to miss so many games. I don't know if he's worth it. I like Jamal Williams. I like Darrell Henderson. We're going to handcuff Cam Akers since we already have him with Darrell Henderson. I think that both of these running backs could be very successful, whoever the starter is. Obviously, going into the season, Cam Akers is going to be the guy if he ends up getting hurt. Knock on wood. We obviously hope that doesn't happen. Cam Akers could take a full stranglehold of this offense and be very strong as long as Stafford and friends move the ball as effectively and as efficiently as I believe that he will. So now we are in round 13 of the draft. So we basically just have our one wide receiver we're going to draft, and then a kicker and a defense, which basically can get fast forwarded to because the picks back there. Actually, the picks back there will matter because assholes are drafting defenses so early that we will be seeing actual players go back there. So that is actually kind of interesting. So after I went with Irv Smith came Hollywood Brown, Nyheim Hines, Darrell Henderson, Jarvis Landry, Devontae Parker, Buffalo defense, and Marvin Jones. Devontae Parker to me is the odd man out in this Dolphins offense. While he has proved himself to be pretty good 2 years ago, last year he was basically limp dick. He could not get it up. He needed some fucking blue chew, not sponsored, some Viagra, something like that. Because he just couldn't get it going. And maybe he can in 2021, but with Waddle, with Will Fuller there, I'm just not too sure it's going to happen, to be honest with you. So he's basically the undesirable one. He's the ugly fucking stepsister in this one. What are you doing, step, bro? After Marvin Jones came Jamal Williams. You like that? Kirk Cousins, Corey Davis. Now, in some leagues where people are drafting a lot of quarterbacks, where you kind of... In that situation where people are taking 2-3 quarterbacks, I feel as though you have to draft a second quarterback, if I'm being completely honest with you, because then you're on the waiver wire with your thumb up your ass and no one's available. There are leagues where literally, like, guys that may not even start, like Cam Newton is a guy you have to play on your roster week in, week out as your quarterback two off the waiver wire, because that's just how it works. So make sure that if you're in a league selecting a lot of quarterbacks that you end up taking two, because otherwise you're going to be paying the price later on in the season if your quarterback was to go down and you're starting fucking Trey Lance every week and Trey Lance doesn't even become the starter yet and you are just so pissed off. That has happened, not to me, but I've seen it happen. So make sure that you're paying attention in your draft to see how many quarterbacks are going. One of my favorite picks of the draft actually just came out the board in Antonio Brown. Call God, business is booming, Mr. AB. I love Antonio Brown in 2021. I think that Mike Evans and Godwin are severely overrated at this point if Antonio Brown is able to get out of the shenanigans and actually be able to stay healthy and not get fucking kicked off the team or get cold feet again. Remember when he had fucking frostbite for the Raiders? Like, crazy stuff like that. Maybe if that doesn't happen, then Antonio Brown can legitimately be very good, because for the 8 games he played, he was very useful in fantasy football. After LaVishka Chenault came Antonio Brown, Trevor Lawrence, and Baker Mayfield. This honestly would be a league where I'd be thinking about taking two quarterbacks with how many have came off the board. I may even do it, to be completely honest with you, because that's just how I try to do these mocks. Like, they're serious. Like, this is a serious draft where I'm betting, or not betting, where I'm putting like $100 down. This is a real life draft. So I try to draft as accurately to what I would actually do as possible. All right, after Baker Mayfield was Janu Smith, Tariq Cohen, Michael Pittman, Austin Hooper, Alexander Mattison, Rob Gronkowski, Danny Dimes, and Jalen Waddle. So where to go with the quarterback here? I like Wentz. I like Fitzpatrick. If you're trying to be safe, go Wentz. If you're playing a little bit more risky, feeling a little more dangerous, go Fitzpatrick. I'm more of a dangerous guy, so I'm going with Ryan Fitzpatrick again. He should probably never be gracing my lineup. Tannehill should be in there every single week. Remember that when you're drafting two quarterbacks, to look at the bye. Again, it seems obvious, but it's so easy to, in the heat of the moment, not be paying attention and to end up drafting two quarterbacks on the same bye, and then you're just fucking screwed. You're not really screwed because you just cut one of them, but you're going to feel like a real dumbass and people will make fun of you. So now we need a defense and a kicker. Again, you want a defense playing an easy offense week one. I don't know every team's schedule off the top of my head just yet. For week one later on in the offseason, I will want to go with the Broncos because they're the highest rated. But again, that's not really how I do it. I try to find the offense or the defense playing a soft offense in week number one so I could go ahead and stream the position. I hope you guys have ended up enjoying this video. I will be on vacation this week, so I hopefully won't be missing any uploads. I'm going to try to record a couple of videos tonight, go to bed, edit them, have them uploaded so you can watch them during the week. But if at any point I miss an upload, just know I was on vacation. I missed an upload yesterday because I was just busy. I've been busy, but yeah, this channel does mean a lot to me. The success it's had, the amount of positivity it has means a lot to me. So I try not to just leave you guys out dry hanging. So I do try to upload every single day, and in July, in August, when people are really watching, when the fucking bright lights are on, I am there every day. It's just, I need a vacation. I've been basically uploading every single day straight for 2 years, and I do need a vacation. I never wanted to take a vacation, but I realized that at the end of the day, this does, like, while you might not think this, right, it's just talking to the fucking computer, it does take a toll on you eventually. It does, but again, no one fucking cares, right? We're doing a fantasy football draft, you know? I'm not asking for any fucking pity or something, right? I'm definitely not saying that because I make videos, right? Like, that's not a hard job. It's not. Even if at times it's tough to upload every single day. Like, it's mostly just mentally tough. But again, I'm not someone who is like sad or something. Like, I'm very happy with where I've been. So, I'll include this in the video, but don't try to be assuming that I'm asking for like some fucking pity or something. Like, I'm good. Trust me. Like, I have fun making these videos. You can't make this many videos. You can't make all these fucking videos if you're not having fun, to be honest with you. And if I wasn't having fun, you could tell. You could tell, because I wouldn't be trying to crack jokes. I wouldn't be trying to do all this stuff. I try to crack jokes. I try to make you guys have fun in these videos. That's the biggest goal, to win your league and to have fun. So I'm hoping you guys do have fun. So back to the real fantasy shit. I'm not trying to get real deep, real personal here. Again, I'm just a talking head on the internet. After Ryan Fitzpatrick came Evan Ingram, Carson Wentz, Denver defense, Lindsey, Cole Kmet, Cleveland defense, Justin Fields, Devontae Smith, a pick I like again, Hayden Hurst, Big Ben, Deshaun Watson, Blake Jarwin, Todd Gurley. Why are we picking backup tight ends? Legitimate backup in the NFL. Anthony Firkser, what a fall from grace. I thought this guy was going to be like sleeper tight end of the century, but with Julio now there, sheesh, I do not like seeing that. After Anthony Firkser came the Miami defense, and we're probably just going to fast forward, honestly, to my final pick. So we're up. Again, that was a fast forward right there, because it does get boring when people are drafting just kickers and defenses. We're getting a kicker, and we're going to go with Tyler fucking Bass. Oh God. Oh Jesus. Oh jeez. Oh Lordy Lord. We got Tyler Bass. So we got Tyler Bass. I actually do like him a lot. Young kicker. Very good for the Buffalo Bills. So to recap our roster, I'll just pull up my team here, read it off here. If you guys have any questions about any of these players that I drafted, you think they're bad picks, just let me know. I'd love to talk to you guys in the comment section. My quarterback is Ryan Tannehill. My wide receivers are Julio Jones and Chase Claypool. We got another Jones on the team in Aaron Jones of the Green Bay Packers, and Cam Akers are two starting running backs. Irv Smith, the starting tight end. Our flex is David Montgomery. Our bench is comprised of Brandon Ayuk, David Johnson, Zach Moss, Jamar Chase, Darrell Henderson, Ryan Fitz Magic. Our kicker is Tyler Bass, and our defense is the Denver Broncos. So I hope you guys did enjoy this. Again, I try to draft up against real people, not the computer, to help you guys out the best in your drafts, because I think that drafting against real people gives you the best idea of what's actually going to be occurring in your draft. Which isn't 100% true, because people do crazy shit in every single draft. Someone might take a kicker in the first round of your draft. Probably not, but you know, anything can really happen. So I hope you guys enjoyed. I love you guys all again. Thank you guys so much for all the support recently. 12,500 subscribers. Hopefully we can hit 20,000 by the start of August, and then by the end of August, 30,000 subscribers. I love you guys all genuinely from deep down in my heart. Thank you guys for everything. All of the support. It really means a lot. It means more than you'll ever know. Trust me. So thank you guys again. Not trying to get sentimental here. Have a great rest of your guys' day. Make sure that you stay safe. Happy Sunday. It's almost the start of the week. Don't have no Sunday scaries. We're going to have a strong week going into the weekend again, because, you know, that's just how it is. You always got to look forward to the weekend. I love you guys all again. Thank you for everything. Make sure you stay safe. Make sure that you remember that I love you. And if you have any questions, make sure to leave them down below in the comments. Have a great rest of your guys' day. Stay safe. Goodbye.